Welcome, everyone. Welcome again to the People's Church Newton Abbey. We're thrilled. We're delighted. We mean this. We're delighted that you're able to be with us again for our gospel outreach at this Christmas time, at this particular time of the year. What an opportunity we have tonight again to explore, to understand and apply the truth claims of the Lord Jesus at Christmas. And that's what we're going to do tonight. The Christmas message has something to say to us constantly. There's so many angles. There's one truth at Christmas, that Jesus came down. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. But there's so much included in that for every one of us tonight. And I want to take another look at something in particular for our outreach tonight. God bless you for being here. We pray you'll receive something from him as we look into his word again. We're going to read from Luke chapter 2 and verse number 1. It's a pretty familiar portion for Christmas. Of course, we're going to hear these passages read and expounded so much, but there's so much in it. And there's something here for us to take and glean about the Lord Jesus and his birth that can speak into our lives tonight. And I pray that it does. We're going to ask a blessing. Can we do that right now? Can we ask a blessing from the Lord as we read his word? Let's just bow our heads. Lord, thank you that you brought us together under the canopy of your presence and of your word. Will you bless your word unto our hearts? Will you glorify your name in us and through us? Oh Lord, tonight you said man shall not live by bread only, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Bless your word. Show us the Lord Jesus again in his radiant glory and majesty. And may we put our all into his hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So Luke chapter 2 and verse number 1, it says, "And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered." This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all the world went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. Now note that in particular, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. We're going to try and bring something out of that tonight that's important. To be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and led him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now that's what we read. That's what we understand about the birth of the Lord Jesus. But there's something that you may not have grasped or fully appreciated with all of this. Because in Bible times, the phrase, the house of, you'll read that phrase in the Old Testament a lot, the house of. Now, that's significant. That phrase, the house of something or someone, it's very, very significant. For an example, Saul was of the house of Kish. We read that in the Bible. Then David said in 2 Samuel chapter 9, "Is there any left of the house of Saul that I might show them kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Or when Israel in Exodus chapter 20 and verse 2 were brought up from, the Bible records here, the house of bondage. That's significant. That phrase that you read in the Bible, the house of, is significant. It marks who they were, where they were from, and what they were involved in as well. Don't miss that right now. The house of is significant. That phrase, those words, the house of, is significant. And when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, it is significant because Bethlehem, the word Bethlehem means the house of bread. The house of bread. And I just want to state right now, it was so appropriate. It was so significant, so meaningful that the Savior was born in Bethlehem, the house of bread, because he came as the bread of life into this darkened world, into this hungry, craving world. He was born in the house of bread, but he was and fulfilled the bread of life sent down from God out of heaven to this world. And that's what I want us to center on tonight. It's interesting that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. He resided in the city of Nazareth, but because of this register, he had to travel, or his earthly parents had to travel prior to his birth to Bethlehem. And it was there where Jesus was born, in Bethlehem, the house of bread. The house of bread, the place that was known as the house of bread. Everyone knew Bethlehem, knew meant the house of bread. And Jesus was born there, and it was so appropriate that he was, because he came as the bread of life. Now that's what Jesus said about himself. You'll remember that in John chapter 6 and verse 37. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst." Then again he said in verse 48, he underlines this again, "I am the bread of life." And I want us to think about that for a little bit tonight at this Christmas time. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the house of bread, but he was born there as he came as the bread of life to this sin-darkened, craving, hungry, unsatisfied world. The bread of life was born in the house of bread. For the time we have left together, I want us to see a couple of things in relation to this. The significance of that bread. The significance of it. What is significant about this? Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." What's significant about that? What was significant in the Lord calling himself that? Well, the first thing we need to really appreciate is, and remember, is that bread is a universal commodity. It really is. You know that. Bread is universal. Every local culture, every civilization in this world has its own form of bread. It's universal. We have soda bread and potato bread in Northern Ireland, and they're wonderful. Other places have other forms of bread, flat bread, pita bread. From in the Middle East, flat bread is such a thing. And all over the world, bread is a universal commodity. It's common all over the world, but it's associated, it's significant because it represents nourishment, it represents sustenance, it represents fulfillment, and it represents satisfaction. And when the Lord Jesus said about himself, "I am the bread of life," what he's saying is this: I'm going to do that for you. I'm going to nourish you. I'm going to fulfill you. I'm going to sustain you. And I'm going to satisfy you. Can you get that? Can you take that on board right now? The bread of life was born in the house of bread. There's a meaning in that. There's a point to that. When Jesus came from the house of bread, he declared himself to be the bread of life. He was proclaiming, he was signifying the nourishment of life, the sustenance of life, the satisfaction of life is found in him. That's the message Jesus was getting across here. It's found in him. All you're looking for is found in him. That's the significance of this tonight. Jesus offers that to people. The Lord brings that about in lives. He's done it for us as Christians. We can put testimony after testimony after testimony after testimony on the screen tonight and keep you here until kingdom comes, of people in this world whom Jesus has not only sustained, fulfilled, but satisfied in their lives. Jesus is the bread of life. He said to us, I am what people need the world over. Bread is that universal commodity. I am the bread of life, Jesus said. People are hungry for stuff today. Have you noticed that? They crave and yet are not satisfied. That's why addictions are so rife. But people aren't satisfied. They're looking for more. That's why one drug leads to another drug. That's why class C drug leads to class B drug, and class B drug leads to class A drug, because they're never satisfied. People are craving. People are hungry. People are looking for more. It can even be success, acclaim, popularity, prosperity, knowledge, and yet more and more and more. They're never really fulfilled. You know what the Bible says about the Lord Jesus, and it's wonderful, in the book of Colossians chapter 2 and verse 10. Here's what the Bible says about Jesus. You are complete in him. You are complete in him. He completes you. He fulfills you. He satisfies. You are complete in him. That's what Jesus does. When you have him, you long no more. When you have him, you crave no more. When you have him, you want no more. He completes you. You are complete in him who is the head of all principality and power. That's Jesus. That's what we need to remember this Christmas time. He was born in the house of bread. He is the bread of life. He came to make people full. That's the significance of this. And don't miss it this Christmas time. This is not about sentimentality. Christmas, the messages of Christmas are not about sentimentality. They're about truth. Christmas, the Christmas message is full of truth claims that God himself has placed there that make a difference in your life and mine. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. The bread of life was born in the house of bread. It's all for a reason. It all coexists. It all is in line for a reason. That's the significance of this. But note the source of this bread. You see, we're told in the Gospels the source of it. Listen to John 6 and verse 33. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to this world. Will you catch that right now? Because that's so important. The bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. We have the source of this here. There was never any doubt where Jesus came from and what he came to do. Listen to it again. The bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to this world. That's the source. Note the phrase, from heaven. From heaven. Jesus came down. That's what the Christmas story is all about. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus came down. Now the people of his day and age, they were comparing this bread to the manna God had supplied his people with. Manna was what God supplied. When Israel were wandering through the wilderness, it was a small, round, sticky wafer which fell from heaven every day, and it met their need every day. It was miraculous. It was never forgotten. Now, here's something maybe you don't know. But many believed that when the Messiah would come, the miracle of the manna would be restored. Many believed that when the Savior would come, the miracle of manna would happen again. The bread would come down out of heaven. But what the Savior is wanting the people here to know is this. He is the true bread. Not in wafer form, but in literal form. Listen to him. I am the one, he said, you're waiting and looking for. John 6:32, Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Then verse 34, Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Now, what does that tell us tonight? Only heaven can really provide what we need. The answer isn't to the right or to the left. The answer is above. Jesus came from heaven. Only heaven can provide what we're really looking for, what we really need, what we really crave. The answer is from above tonight. Do you realize that? You know, we have a culture, and it's so apparent at the minute, where it's right and left. Are you to the right or are you to the left? Politically speaking now, socially speaking, right or left, right wing or left wing, right and left. But we fail to realize something. With all the right and the left that's gone on, there's an up and a down as well. And they're most important, the up and the down. We need to be looking up, not to the right, not to the left. Only heaven can provide what we really need. That's the source of this today. But the meaning of this cannot be forgotten. Unless the bread is tasted, it can never be really appreciated. Unless you taste it, you can't really appreciate it. And so here's what I'm saying now at the end. The sample of the bread. The Bible is very clear on this. Taste and see that the Lord is good. That's what Psalm 34:8 says. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste and see that he's good. Sample for yourself. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. He has to be tasted. A lot of people don't like trying something for the first time. They're apprehensive, little bit frightened, little bit unsure, don't like the smell of something, don't like a look of something. There's a great many people in our society today are like that, even with the Christian gospel and the ways of God and the Lord Jesus himself. Maybe they've been put off in the past. Maybe they have a misrepresentation. Maybe something got on in their mind or whatever. But unless a person really samples Jesus for themselves, they'll never really appreciate who he really is. And that's why the Bible says, you've got to taste and see that the Lord is good. Have you done that? Have you really done that? This is more than going to church. This is more than saying a prayer. This is you and your life opening yourself to let him to come into you in a real, real way. And when you do that 100%, when you do that with all of your heart, you get the real him. You get the experience, the real Jesus. And that's life transforming. That's life changing. You'll never be the same again when that happens. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. You know, a person can walk into a bakery and smell the fresh bread. And we've got it now. We've got patisseries everywhere. Even our supermarkets are making their own fresh bread. You walk in, you smell it. You walk in and it's golden, the crust. And it's amazing. You can look at it and whatever. But you've got to taste it. You've got to commit to it. You've got to taste it. You've got to purchase it. You've got to taste it. You've got to commit to it. And when you do, it's the taste that really matters. And you know what the Bible says with confidence? Taste and see that the Lord is good. That's what happened to us as Christians. We didn't find church. We found the bread of life. That's what happened to us as Christians. That's why we're never the same again. That's why we're so passionate for him. Because we have taken him into ourselves. He's taken us and we feed on him every day, and we come to him every day, and he fills us every day, and he satisfies, and there's no one like him. But you've got a taste for yourself. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. You know something? The bread of life was born in the house of bread. It's significant. Bethlehem is called the house of bread. For generations of time, all people realized that Bethlehem was called the house of bread, but Jesus was born there. And it's really appropriate because he is the bread of life. That's the source of it, the significance of it. You've got to sample him, but this bread was also broken. You need to realize that. You need to realize that. The Lord Jesus talked about that, talked about his body. In 1 Corinthians 11:24, it says, when he given thanks, this is the first communion. This is the meaning. He talked about his body, and the bread was his body, he said. And he took the bread and he broke it visually before them. And he says, this is my body broken for you. And in that broken bread, the symbol of it, the image of it, and they knew his body would be pierced and given up, was the proof of his love. The proof of his love was in that. He said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. You see, you have to nourish on Jesus. You have to nourish on him as a person. You've got to come to him in that spiritual sense every day and feed on him. That's why the old male voice choirs and wheels and all said, bread of heaven, feed me now and evermore. Because you can and you must. And stop feeding on the worthless things of this life that aren't filling you anyhow, and a lot of them are destroying people. You've got to break that and let him help you break that, and he'll do it for you. But feed on him. Oh, I tell you, there's no one like Jesus tonight. The bread of heaven was born in the house of bread. Do you know him like this Christmas time? The reality of him. We thank God for every representation of Christmas. We thank God for everything about it. But it's not sentimentality. It's not sentiment. It's reality. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the house of bread. But he became and is the bread of life. He says, he who comes to me will never hunger and will never thirst. Oh, I tell you tonight, what are you feeding on? What are you craving? What are you feeding on? What are you hungering after? You know, if you're not careful in the end, you'll be disappointed. But not with Jesus. He's never a disappointment. And I believe tonight he's reaching out to people all over the world, the bread of life. And you know, you can take him as your own. And you can come to him. And he fills you every day. And he nourishes you. And he builds you up. And there's nothing like that. That's what it's all about. And that's what Christmas is all about. Because he came so that that could happen. The bread of life was born in the house of bread. Do you know him in this way? Have you got him in this way? If you haven't, will you do something about it tonight? Will you come to him? Will you call out to him? Will you cry out to him? Will you come the way you are? Will you come with all of your heart? Will you open yourself? Because if you do, he'll come into you. He talked about standing at the door and knocking. He's talking about human hearts now. He says about, if you will open the door, I will come in and sup with you and you with me. That's what he wants. And he fills you in that. And he fills you up in that. And there's nothing like it. And if you haven't got that, you haven't got anything that's really lasting. Because only Jesus can satisfy. The bread of life, born in the house of bread. I want to pray a prayer to end off. I hope you've just seen the Lord Jesus tonight. I want to pray a prayer. And if you don't have the reality of him in your life, you can have it right now. If you pray with all your heart, if you make this prayer your channel, because he will respond to that. If we confess our sins, he will cleanse us, we're told. And that can happen in this prayer, not to me, but to him now. We're going to bow our heads. Let's pray. And I'm going to pray a simple prayer, but think about every word. And you can pray it too. And may it come from your heart. Lord, I come to you. Just as I am. But I believe you love me. Just as I am. I give you my life tonight. I open my heart tonight. Come in to me. Come in today. Come in and stay, Lord Jesus. I pray that you'll fill me with your presence, with your forgiveness of my sins. I pray you'll cleanse me from this night and fill me that I could live for you forevermore. Lord, hear my prayer tonight. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to you. I give you my life. I give you my all. Receive me on the grounds of your word and promise, because you said if I call, you'd hear and you'd save me. Lord, do that tonight, because I need you. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you, everyone. The Lord has heard your prayer. We're rejoicing in the Lord this Christmas time. We're rejoicing in the messages of Christmas. There's so much in it. They're not just nice little things. They're truth claims. And they're real. And they're more important now than ever. We're looking forward to this week because we've got so much on. Our call to prayer tomorrow night. Bible study on Wednesday night. We're here every day. If you need us, please let us know. And thank you for all your encouragement. Thank you for all you do. But rejoice in the Lord tonight. Rejoice this Christmas time. He's with you. He came to be with you. And rejoice that you have him forevermore. Amen, everyone. God bless you. We'll see you during the week. God bless. Mm-hmm.